we're doing about the thorn in the flesh, what it is, what it isn't. Don't read things into the Bible that aren't there. That's how we got all this goofy stuff going around. The phrase thorn in the flesh always referred to a people or a person, never to sickness or disease. Every time the phrase is used, it always tells specifically what the thorn was. So like three times in the Bible, three out of three, 100% of the time, it was talking about a people group. It never was taught to be a sickness or a disease. Paul was a Bible scholar. He would have known what the phrase meant, and his hearers would have known what the term meant. God told Ananias to heal Paul and tell him what he would suffer for Jesus' sake, not that he was suffering his blindness for Jesus' sake. Things Paul suffered. Sounds kind of what they did to Jesus, don't it? Same group of people. Jews determined to kill Paul right after his conversion. He was hindered in journeying the Christians. He was opposed by Satan. He was opposed by Jews in a mob. Kind of like the religious spirit and Satan are on the same team, don't it look like? He was opposed by the Jews in a mob. He was expelled out of Antioch in Pisidia. He was mobbed and expelled from Iconium. He fled to Lystra and Derbe, where he was stoned and left for dead. He was disputing continually by false brethren. So that this message, when you hear it, people are going to make up everything around it and say why it shouldn't work. And you know, after millions of documented hearings for 100 years, you'd think they'd finally hate. He was fled out of Lystra and Derbe, where he was stoned and left for dead. That's twice. He was disputed kidney by false brethren. He was beaten in jail at Philippi. He was mobbed and expelled from Thessalonica. He was mobbed and expelled from Berea. He was mobbed at Corinth. He was mobbed at Ephesus. There was a plot against his life by the Jews. He was seized by Jews, mobbed, tried in court 5 times, and suffered other hardships. Paul prayed that his thorn would be removed. Nowhere in the New Testament does everybody pray for God for healing. That alone should say, well, he prayed. Well, God never told you to pray for sickness to leave. I don't know why pastors are telling people still to pray for the sick. You can't find it. It just amazes me. And nowhere in the New Testament has any person ever told to ask God for healing. Oh God, please heal me. He said, I already did. Just telling you what the book says.
Yep.
Pretty hard to argue with all these written scriptures. Why did he get it? Because of his revelations. You know, I'm going to use somebody here again. Come here. Here's what God says. My grace is sufficient. He said, I give you power over all the works of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall harm me. Now, whose job is it to make the devil leave, mine or his?
Bill.
So why do we keep asking God to do it? He said, Mike, I already gave it to you, Paul. Well, why didn't God take it away? Because he gave Paul the ability to make it leave on his own. Why are we asking God to do it when he told us, he commanded us to go do it? You go destroy the works of the enemy. Why do we keep asking God to do what he commanded us to do? Would you be happy if your kid did that? Wait a minute. Just so you really feel out of place, ask me for them keys.
May I have the keys?
You already got them, son. Ask me again. Ask me 10,000 more times. You see how dumb we've been? And we got people teaching you to ask God to give you something you already got. Well, he said, I already gave it to you. They're waiting for him to pour out the Spirit. It already happened 2,000 years ago.
Right.
By his stripes you were, past tense, already healed 2,000 years ago. God's already given it all to you. You got to tell the devil what to do. You got to tell your body what to do. Think you get the eye thing. Anybody know that Paul wasn't sick now, right? He had to write such a large letter. Not big letters, large. Meant like a long letter. That's another false teaching. You know, Paul had bad eyes. He wrote a large letter. Where did you get that? It wasn't large print. It was a big letter. Long. look how long the letter was. How many pages was the letter of Galatians? I never wrote that much in my whole life, let alone in one time. I'm trying to be nice. I keep wanting to say things I know I shouldn't. Like how dumb, I'll use his term. What is it? You're dumber than a back bag of hammers?
Dumber than a bag of hammers. Walk for all.
Yeah, like, how come you can't get this? Two and two is this many. Quit trying to tell people it's something different. Just read the words that are there and say, yep, that's God's word. It's not my idea. Oh, the Galatians would have plucked out their eyes. For you know through the infirmity of my flesh, I preached the gospel unto you at the first. And my temptation was that my flesh ye despise not, nor rejected, but receive me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Where is then the blessedness ye spake of? For I bear you record that if you had been possible, you have plucked out your own eyes and would have given them to me. You know when I say I'd cut off my right arm to help you? I'd give you my right arm to help you. Does it mean I'm going to go get a saw? A thorn in the flesh was kind of like a pain in my butt. If I said I had a pain in my butt, would you think my butt hurt? That guy's a pain in my butt. What would you think I was telling you? He just causes me grief. If I told you I'm going to cut my right arm, would you go out and tell everybody, well, Dave has a bad right arm. Yeah. He'd give his right arm to help you. Come on, use a little of it.
A little ditch.
Paul explained his hardship, blow after blow, could never be a sickness and disease, either you got or you don't, and don't buffet you. But persecutors do. They beat you time after time after time and kick you and stone you and leave you for dead. He already listed it. Paul left people sick somewhere. Well, you heard the testimony, just like ours. Not everybody is healed instantly. Most of them were. But they see it still continuing.
Yes.
Even Jesus' day, they weren't all instantly healed. Most of them were, but there was some that took a little bit. You know, when he cursed the fig tree, was it instant or take a while? When you curse a sickness and disease, sometimes it takes a while for that life to drain out. I don't like any better than you. I like it less than you do. I want to see bang, 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 bang miracles. I want to see him straighten right out. I'm going to hook a chain and help him a little bit. Straighten him out, but I know that ain't God's will. That's my will. I'm willing. If God told me to do it, I'd do it. I just want to see everybody whole, set free. But do you see how dumb we've been in the church and some of the stuff we teach people? Okay, the next one's going to be Timothy's stomach. There's been, well, you know, take a little wine for your stomach. Anybody know what you do on a missionary trip when you drink strange water?
Boil it.
What happens if you don't boil it? Oh. That's what happened. He was a young man, and all the old guys, you're trying to change from the Jewish system right at the turning point to a new covenant. And Timothy was a young man, probably nervous, like I used to get butterflies and almost sick to my stomach getting in front of people. It wasn't until about 6 months ago I didn't get totally just scared to death up here. So a lot of times I'd walk off the side. I wasn't so sure I wasn't going to get sick sometime, but I kept faking it until I overcame it. Only took 9 years. And if you take a little wine and put it in the water, what does it do to the water?
Purifies
it. So if you got an upset stomach with a bunch of bacteria growing, because they didn't have all the modern medicine, what happens if you put a little wine? It purifies it. It kills the bad bacteria. Not that hard to understand. Not telling you to go drink a couple bottles and really purify it. Yeah, I really do a good job. We got some overachievers in this place. Well, if a drop's a good, a gallon must be better, right? No, not necessarily.
I'm teaching that.
Divine healing by faith. There's three kinds of healing mentioned in the Bible. This is going to make it really easy. You keep thinking that's like cooking. You got 1,000 different recipes. The recipes are really simple. I don't care how you make them work. There's three kinds of healing. You can get healed by your own faith. God, I just accept you as my healer right now. That's most of the way how I got healed. There wasn't nobody praying for me. Not in a good way. They were praying they wouldn't have to put up with me anymore. They were the ones running over and trying to kill me, and actually did a couple times. You get healed by someone else's faith. We can get you healed in our faith. I'd rather you get it on your own, but we'll get it here for you if you can't. Or you can get someone else healed by your faith. Now, one of the things we've learned is if you got a stubborn case, like my buddy James, he broke his back. So I broke mine twice. So don't whine to me about it. I did it twice as much as you did. We're block layers. We still throw and lift a lot of weight. You don't blame me, I'll wrestle with you. And I had a couple people do that. I had a bodybuilder who was going to wrestle, and he ended up on the ground. I said, all I did is pray with one finger. I touched you, and the power of God nailed you to the front lawn. I know, it's just not fair. I can lift over 400 pounds, but you can't lift me. Our weapons are not carnal. They're not physical. They are spiritual. As soon as the devil gets you in this realm, he beats you. Stay out of that realm. You want to win? Don't go into his realm. Stay in God's realm. But we could get the pain to leave his back, and like a yo-yo. And finally I said, you know, if you pray for enough backs, your back's going to get healed in the middle of it. Simple sowing and reaping. The reason we don't get sick, we're always getting everybody else healed. We're pouring out healing. And you'll have some troubled areas that you got to start focusing on. You can be healed by faith or authority. People don't know that. You can just declare it. It's done. Or by faith. You can get healed by a gift. And we'll get into that, and it'll probably make some of you upset again. Because the only gifts are only operating in a couple places in the New Testament. And that was one of the things I always asked. I said, how come they didn't tell all the different churches about the gifts that are so important? And you know, I heard more dumb answers than anything. Why didn't all of them need the gifts? They're already acting like sons. They didn't need to be babies again. Who can have great faith? Anybody here in here have great faith? Raise your hand if you have great faith. It's a trick question, so watch it. I'd like to lead you to sinner's prayer. Because if you need great faith, it means you're not in the covenant. If you're born again, you don't need faith. It's already got the keys. How much faith does it take to use what you already got? In Scripture, there's only two places you can have great faith. And they were not in the covenant. They were out of the covenant. And we're going to read about them right now. I told you this was good. We've been taught a bill of goods.
Yeah.
The Roman centurion, and Jesus was entered into Capernaum, and there came unto him a centurion, beseeching him, saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus said to him, I will come and heal him. You notice it doesn't say the Spirit of God told him to go do it? He just seen the need, and he met it. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh. And to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. And Jesus heard it, he marveled, and said unto them that followed, verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. And I say unto you that many shall come from the east and the west, and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out of the outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said unto the centurion, go thy way, as thou hast believed, so it be done unto thee. And his servant was healed from that same hour. Only two places, and they were not in the covenant. So as soon as you say you have great faith, you're automatically saying, I'm out of covenant. In other words, you're not born again. Because if you're born again, you're in covenant. Just make up your mind, are you in covenant or not? That's why we don't get a lot of our prayers answered, because we're double-minded. We're not quite sure if we're in or not. Like, which way to go? Which way to go? Matthew 15, 22, the woman of Canaan. This is a good one. And I'll elaborate on this, and it will make sense to you. And behold, the woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But he answered her not a word, and his disciples came and besought him, saying, Send her away, for she crieth after us. But he answered and said, I'm not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, Is not meet to take the children's bread and to cast it to dogs. And she said, Truth, Lord, yet the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from their master's table. And Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Notice that the only people ever told by Jesus that had great faith were two people that were not covenant people. If you own a vehicle and you get the title and the keys, how much faith does it take to get in and drive it? But if it's not your car, not you don't own it, it might take great faith to go steal some keys and take off with it. See the difference? One, you have no legal right to. It's our Father's good pleasure. He's already said He's gave it all to us. All the switches are flipped in our favor already. We don't have to get Him to do something. It ain't like you got to twist His arm behind His back and say, Daddy, I need this. I already gave it to you, son. That's the only thing He can say. They had no covenant with God. Therefore, it was truly amazing that they had the faith to ask God, Jesus, for anything. They had no right to ask. When you have no right to ask, it takes great faith to ask. Jesus rebuked his disciples because they did not display the same degree of confidence in God. Jesus, as the two heathen people did. Wouldn't you be proud to be one of the disciples and the heathens had more faith than you? And two were standing there when he's saying that, hey, they have great faith. They ain't seen this in the whole country. Right. He didn't say, man, good boy, job, boys. You really learned good. Nowhere in the New Testament, after Jesus' resurrection, are Christians ever told to have faith. Christians do not have a faith problem. They have faith or they are not born again. The only faith you have is saying, God, I'd like you to be my Lord. Okay, now you're in covenant. It's His good pleasure to give you everything else. An important point to note here is, the Roman centurion was not in covenant with God. Yet he had apparently heard that Jesus healed people, that He would heal people. When he heard this, faith came by hearing the word of God. And the centurion acted upon the word that he had heard. Faith was mixed with the word and he profited. He went and said, hey, I hear this Jesus guy heals people. I'm going to go see him. Faith is an action word. Right? Mm-hmm. You don't act on it. Do you see any miracles?
No.
Pretty simple, though, really, ain't it? Once you get it working, did you ever dream it could be so simple? Like, wow, all my life I was told how hard it was. And I had it here all my time. All I got to do is go like this and believe. Really, if you really want to know what faith is, what English tells faith, it's believing authority. I have the authority to forgive sins. I have the authority to tell people to rise up and walk. I have the authority to tell the devil to leave.
Amen.
It's acting on God's word and knowing who you are in Christ. The woman of Canaan had no covenant with God. No. Also, that both of these people came from the healing deliverance of someone else. Did you notice that? They didn't come to get their own stuff. It wasn't me. Hey, I know somebody in need, my daughter. I know somebody in need, my servant. Jesus, will you heal my servant, my daughter? His answer was always what?
Yeah.
It's always my will to do that. Jesus actually turned the woman down, saying it wasn't right to give the children bread to dogs. First thing he did was call her a dog. This was a direct reference to her not being in covenant relationship with God. It also tells us that healing and deliverance are the children's bread. It's your right to walk in divine health. Jesus taught his disciples to pray for daily bread, daily healing. Jesus also said he was the bread of life that came down from the heavens. He is our healing. He doesn't have our healing or give us healing. He is our healing. If we have him, we have healing already. Ephesians 1:3 says that God has already blessed us with every spiritual blessing. What else is he going to give you if he already gave you every one of them? Either you believe the word or you don't. Well, God, I don't believe you give it to me all yet. I need it. If your kid wanted $5 to go buy something, you already gave him $5, and he come over and said, Dad, I need $5. He said, I already give it to you. Would you really think he was great, trying to get more from you? I already gave it all to you, son. Ephesians 1:3 says that God has already blessed us with every spiritual blessing. As Christians, we already have healing. We received it when we received Jesus. Our job now is to drive out the enemy of God that would try to keep us from walking in our healing. Once we evict the outlaw called sickness or disease, we live in divine health God has provided through the death and resurrection of Jesus. We are healed. We were healed when we got saved. Now we must drive out the enemy that is living illegally in God's property. How many people would let a burglar come live in their house and home for a couple years? Why not? We do that with sickness in our body. We don't fight. And you know why we don't fight? We've been taught that God's teaching us something. You don't have the authority. You don't have the ability. That's hogwash. We fight until it leaves. Notice that also that one of the people that Jesus said had great faith was a soldier. He said he understood authority. Therefore, he knew Jesus could heal his servant. Understanding authority is the key to walking in faith. If you always think you've got to get something, you'll never take it and use it. Can you imagine a tool? I should bring some tools sometime. You ask me for a screwdriver, and I give you a screwdriver, and there's a screw that needs to be tightened, and you keep asking me for the screwdriver I just put in your hand. You already got it, son. Now go tighten that screw. You see how simple it really is? Quit shooting at heaven and asking him for something you already got. Start shooting at the enemy and the works of the enemy, and your success rate will go through the roof. It's really simple. And you'll look like you really know something. And all you're doing is reading the Bible and saying, yep, it's true. It's true. You act on it. But if you're still sitting there confused, well, you know, I really don't know what the truth is. And then you'll be double-minded and you can expect what? Nothing. You got to make up your mind, which is true. This young man, we were talking at break. And without even using any spiritual gifts, somebody told him he was going to be a prayer warrior. Now, is anywhere in the New Testament commanded or told you to be a prayer warrior? Is there any scripture to back that up? Can that be from heaven? I don't care who said it. And I'm glad I really don't know them people. He told you could be apostles, prophets, evangelists, preachers, or teachers, right? Amen. Or you're a sheep. Yeah. Where in the New Testament does he tell you to be a prayer warrior? I'm just telling you what the book says. Tell me I'm wrong. You can say, well, that ain't of God. And it hits you right here. It hits me right here. When somebody speaks me a revelation, like when Jason was up here, or Dave, it hits me right here in my heart. Whoa! Wow, that's revelation. That came from heaven. He said, my sheep will know my voice, and they will follow me, and they will not follow another.
Amen.
Is it true or not?
Amen.
I do this about every other weekend for the last 2 years. I want to get this right. So if you can prove out of 2 scriptures, I got something wrong, we want to know about it. But we've been doing this for 100 years. And nobody can find scripturally wrong. They don't like it because we were sold the bill of goods before. Would Jesus ever tell you to be a servant? He told you to be a son. Oh God, please, please, please. That's old covenant. That was done away with 2,000 years ago. He said, I'm waiting for the sons of God to manifest himself and make my enemy my footstool so I can come back. When we're praying that God comes and does it, well, stop it. Start taking care of the enemy and he'll show up and we can go home. And I'm really telling you, home is a lot better than this place. I don't care if you're the richest person on earth. Wait till you see what you get in home. See, this ain't my home.
Nope.
I have a real hard time staying here a lot of times. You can ask my wife and others. I'm wanting to get this job done so we can all go home and have our glorified bodies and we don't have to deal with this other stupid stuff. Only two people were ever told by Jesus that they had great faith and we don't even know their names. Both these people had faith in Jesus for healing and neither were born again. You see, when you get truth, it's really hard to believe some of that other hogwash. When I get a hold of this, I want to tell everybody. And we're doing our best. Who gets to decide when you're healed, you or God? Huh? Are you sure?
Yeah.
I got scriptures, I'm going to read them to you. The woman with the issue of blood decided when she would be healed. For she said within herself, if I may but touch his garment, I shall be made whole. She decided how she would be healed and when she would be healed. Then she carried out what she had said within herself. Jesus didn't even know who had been healed. Her faith pulled the power of God out of her. Did we demonstrate that 2 weeks ago?
Yes.
Can anybody do that?
Yes.
I know you guys both did. How many of your people in your church seen it? They didn't believe it before. Wow, I got healed when I touched her. And I wasn't even trying to be the center of attention. I'm just kind of the fire starter. Actually, I haven't even started. I pour gas on the fire you already got. It's more scripture. I don't get you. I can't give you nothing except revelation. If you're trying to get an impartation from somebody, I'd recommend against it. Only God can give you gifts. You're probably going to get something you don't want in the long run.
Exactly.
But I can stir you up and I can give you revelation of what you already got. If you're born again and filled with the Holy Ghost, is there anything else in the Bible that says you're lacking?
No.
Does it say you need a second or third impartation?
Nope.
No.
Thank you. Quit running around trying to get something. You might get something you don't want and can't get rid of very easily.
That's probably
amen.
We're always trying to get an anointed man of God so they can lay hands on us, but many times the scripture tells us that people touch Jesus and we're healed. There's another scripture that said the same thing. We read this already, I'll do it again quick. Now when he came nigh to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and much people of the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her. Oh, he was led by the Spirit. No. He already knew. See the difference? Babies have to be told what to do, how to do it, and how to do everything. But being a baby is okay. The last 10 times God told me to do this, it's always his will to do this. If you see somebody hurting, you've got God's permission, actually his command, to go get them healed. Lay in, believe. And he said unto her, weep not. And he came and touched the prior casket, and they that were bare him stood still. And he said, young man, I say unto you, thee rise. And he that was dead sat up and began to speak, and he delivered him to his mother. And there came a fear on all, and they glorified God and say that a great prophet has risen up among us, and that God had visited his people. Notice that Jesus had compassion on the mother and raised her son from the dead. The boy was raised by Jesus because he felt compassion for the grieving mother. It wasn't even the grieving dead. One with the issue of blood. And behold, the woman that was diagnosed with an issue of blood 12 years came behind him. We just had this happen over Skype last week. The lady I didn't even know, somewhere out in Virginia area. And she'd had everybody in the world pray for her, every ministry. She found out about us. She was on the life team meeting on Skype. I said, well, that's easy. I'm just going to pray that you have a visitation tonight. She called us the next morning and said she had a vision of Jesus walking in, and she got up totally healed the next morning. 5 years with the issue of blood. She was on her, you watched last week's TV show on her website, you can see her whole testimony. She's like the happiest young lady you ever met. She said within herself, in my bed, touch his garment, I shall be made whole. But Jesus turned to him about, and when he saw her, he said, daughter, be of good comfort, thy faith hath made thee whole. And the woman was made whole from that very that hour. Jesus heals two blind men. When Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying and saying, thou son of David, have mercy on us. And he was come into the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said to him, believe ye that I am able to do this? And they said unto him, ye, Lord, or yea, Lord. Then touched their eyes, saying, according to your faith be it done unto you. And their eyes were opened, and Jesus straightly charged them, saying, see that no man knoweth it. Here's a question that was asked. We've already answered it several times. Somebody wrote this on a card. Now, is there any other scripture in the whole New Testament that confirms this? Any at all? One-time event. I'll read it first and then I'll explain. It was for baby Christians that used to be Jews that were used to getting slobbered with oil. Old Testament, you poured the oil, the Holy Ghost came. New Testament, you lay hands on the sick, the Holy Ghost comes. But they were used to it, so I'm not telling you not to do it. Jesus never used oil to heal anybody. Peter never did. Paul never did. It's only a one-time event. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if he committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. That word saved means sozo, which means the whole package deal.
Amen.
Don't try to make up things. Just read the words that are there. We're not just baptism. We believe in salvation only. It's a whole package. It's everything in the atonement is yes and amen. All the promises are yes and amen. Okay, if somebody don't get healed, is it the sick person's fault?
No.
No.
Is it God's fault?
No.
It only leaves one. Look in the mirror.
Amen.
What?
For that person.
If they don't get healed, you didn't pray in faith. You prayed in sympathy. You prayed in everything but faith. Because God always honors faith. I know I hated it. It really makes you hold accountable. You know how I overcame it? I only had a couple people that actually really loved me in my life. It was my grandmother, who was more like my mother. And I watched her die at a young age of cancer. She had a stroke when I was 6 and shriveled up and died. I pray like it's life and death to her. Like I had a second chance. I pray that way for every one of them. And you, some of you experienced it. When I touched you, what did it feel like?
Like a bolt of lightning and then just warm.
I'd rather give you too much, make sure it's a one-time deal. I don't pull punches. I just soon give it all to you and be done with it.
Amen.
I hope you hear my heart. I might look like a hard case sometime, but my job is to get you set free, healed, empowered, and activated. You can do it too. You know, if I'm off a little bit, just think about it. You know, I blasted something more than once. What if I'm at 25% and I blast you four times? 25, 50, 75, I still get 100%. What if I'm at 10%? Last year, the blind lady blasted 12 times that she could read. I was only at 8. Be glad, that's why we give you our phone number. We will blast you every day. But please call us because we have thousands of people. We can't call everybody back anymore. A couple of years we did. We had to get new phones. Last I knew, we had 4,000 some phone numbers. We got to put states by them too. You remember me? Well, some of you I do, but after thousands and tens of thousands of people, I'm not that good at names. See, it's called the prayer of faith. Can you pray the prayer of faith with if?
No.
With the word if in it?
No.
Well, I'm going to pray the prayer of faith if it be your will, God.
No. No.
You just nullified the whole thing.
If it's the word of God.
You know, do you know if it's your car or not? If I was going to say, I just decided I want to take your car, would you tell me it's not my car? Or would you say, well, you know, I really don't know if it's my car or not? So you got to settle this. No, this is my right. This is my responsibility. No! If I tried to steal some of your stuff, you'd probably get upset with me. The devil's been stealing your healing and your miracles for years. Get ticked off at him. No!
Amen.
Would you be nice to a burglar if he walked in your house and steal you blind?
No.
Okay, don't be nice to the devil. You love the people, you hate the devil.
Right.
If you're angry at somebody, don't get mad at God. Get mad at the devil. He's the one that did it.
That's right.
Get good and ticked off. Start. The every time the devil hits me, we start making declarations. We go find more meetings. We get busy doing it. Devil, you hit me again, and we're going to have more. Mm-hmm. You know, the devil's kind of stupid, but he don't hit us very often anymore. Cause he hits me, and he takes out 100 of my people. He gets a whole bunch more people activated. Come on, devil, hit me again. See what happens then. You really get me torqued on. I'll get 10,000 people trained up. I'll get 100,000 trained up. I can only pray for so many people in my lifetime, but I can train up people to train up people to train up people. We can take this world back. Yeah. Do you imagine if all the Christians were healed, delivered, born again, filled with the Holy Ghost doing this? We don't have enough buildings. Training centers, not churches as you suppose. People that are doers of the word, not hearers only.
Amen.
It's going to get really good later, ain't it?
Yes.
You're like, wow, what's this? Now, I know this is really deep theology, and I know you've never heard this before, but this is the last thing Jesus told the believers. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world. Where did he tell you to go?
To the world.
Is there anywhere he told you not to go?
No.
So anybody that tells you not to go somewhere, whose team are they working for? God's or somebody else's?
Somebody else's.
And preach the gospel to every creature. Could God ever say not to preach it to somebody?
No.
Good answer. What gives you the right? Well, they weren't hearing the gospel in some of these places. I named them before. I won't do it again yet. He that believed is baptized shall be saved. That means the whole package. That word was sozo again. Healed physically, healed mentally, set free, delivered, born again. The whole package. But he that believeth not shall be
damned.
I didn't say that.
I believe.
Thank you. So don't get mad at me. I'm just the messenger. I'm the one that's telling you can do this too. And you'll get as many love letters as we get. And these signs shall follow him that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils, and they shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. Don't go around grabbing snakes. That's not what it means.
Right. You know they call me to have me get snakes out of people's houses?
That's not what they're talking about. They're talking about demons. We got a bunch of snake handlers over in Kentucky or somewhere in the hills thinking they got to get bit by snakes all the time to find out they have faith. Snakes and scorpions, if you do a study on it, it's demons. Things of the not of God. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. I've had people poison me. You know, they kept Zuzu Street, they used to put strychnine and stuff in all their water. Their water pots, 100 years ago, you sit out on the porch. lot of people got saved because I poisoned all you guys and you woke up with no side effects. I'm not telling you to drink poison on purpose. Don't be stupid.
Right.
But if you do, God's going to watch out for you. That's why I drink Coke all the time. And drink any deadly thing, it won't harm you.
It's poison.
They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. So then, after the Lord had spoken unto me, received up into heaven and sat at the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. What signs followed them?
Healing, casting out devils, raising the dead.
Good answer. And they spoke in tongues. Did they speak in tongues in the church, or was it a sign for the people that were the believers? Was the signs for the people that weren't in church or the ones that were in church?
Both, I would say.
Well, there shouldn't be any sick believers. You know, the first 300 years, they didn't have any sick believers. It wasn't until the theologians made a third category. I'm a believer and I'm sick. Well, you can't find that in the Bible. And we'll prove that scripturally. You can get upset with me then. Someone must have faith. Many times Jesus said, according to thy faith, be it unto you. Anytime Jesus saw a person demonstrate faith, he commanded it. But there are many examples of Jesus healing a third party. Healing can be appropriated for you by your faith. Healing can be ministered to you by someone operating Christian authority. Be healed. We've had amazing testimony just speaking the word over the phone. We did it again at break time. Somebody helped us with it. Do you need three or four people? No, but I'd rather give them too much. I don't want to have to take a second shot. I don't know what their circumstances are, but I want to see that person get what they need.
Amen.
And maybe I'm off. Maybe Dave's on. Maybe Dave and me are both off. Maybe Patty's on or Jason. And we got four or five people. What's it took? 2 minutes? You've heard us do it. How long the longest one took? 2-3 minutes? 6 of us? Blast. All you're doing is releasing the kingdom. It's going to be so simple. And how much faith do I need to push this button and turn the light on?
0.
I just expect when I push that button, I know I got a double clicker thing here. I was trying to find a lamp where I could just click it on. Life! That's flowing. As long as I don't turn that switch off, I don't pull my faith back, it's still working. It's still working. I did not pull my faith back. It's still working. See how simple it is? Do I have to figure out how that thing makes light?
No.
Nope. And actually, that will slow me down. Like, wait a minute. I'm not sure if I push that button. Now, that battery's got enough charge. I don't know if there's enough juice in that. That's what stops you. Just push the button. Life, 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 life. I showed you the LaDonna one. All I did was grab her hand and say, life. Meaning the healing lines stand in proxy for another person that there is not, that is not there. Why couldn't the one standing and have faith for an absent person, but I can't have faith for the one in front of me? I'll tell you why. If you start believing what your eyes see, a lot of times on the phone you don't see how gruesome it really is. We've seen some gruesome ones. Last year we got called down to the emergency room. They give a lady less than 2 days to live. It's a white lady, and her arms were blacker than your coat. And her legs were, all the way to her shoulders. They're going to cut her arms and legs off so she can live another 24 hours. That's just wrong in every sense. So me and my wife and James laid hands on her. Next day, she's getting better. All her organs shut down. Life support, I mean, there was no hope. So we blasted her again the third day. They took her off life support. They did end up taking the ends of her fingers and the ends of her toes because they wouldn't let us go back again. I believe when we kept blasting, she wouldn't have lost any of it, but she's alive in Ames.
Actually, I was doing
But when you walk into them places and you see some of that, some of them people are really, you don't even know why they're alive in the first place. Okay. I've been through a lot of hell, so it doesn't affect me as bad. Earlier this year, we were up in Wisconsin, right after the 100% meeting at the Mexican church, and they said, "Will you go to my friend's house? Her son had a car accident, and he's paralyzed from the neck down." Now, I've seen people paralyzed before. This one was ugly. He had a trachea and a machine making him breathe. He could talk only. He was a vegetable. His mom was in the room. A couple bastards were with us, thought they knew it all, you know, and I'm kind of hanging back. They walked in the door, and you could just hear him gasp. So I walked over and said, "You know, I broke my neck twice, my back twice, my sternum twice. I've been dead, blind, and crippled." And I said, "We're going to pray, and God's going to heal you." I already done it. The difference between me and the guy that said they could do it, I already done it. I already experienced it. We blasted him a couple times, nothing really changed. And all of a sudden, because we were stepping out in faith, God dropped it on me and my wife at the same time, getting filled with the Holy Ghost. We let him in a sinner's prayer just to make sure. He took off in tongues and he went, boom. He started arm wrestling me. Started arm wrestling the guy next time. I got his legs going. It looked like he was riding a bicycle. He still hadn't been up walking. We went back several times. Every time we were in Wisconsin, we stopped by him. Told him to call us every day. He did for a week. And part of the problem, he don't think he's worthy because he was driving his girlfriend, the love of his life, was killed. He's still blaming himself. We're trying to convince him that he's forgiven.
God thinks he is.
You're right.
I know he is.
But you can only push a person so far. We had him up running. He could feel his back and spine. We actually had him up front praying for people and they were getting healed. See, God wants him healed and he knows that, but he still won't forgive part of himself. He wants... Well, you know, everybody's really going to make fun of it. If I get totally healed, then my girlfriend, their family's mad at me. You can't bring back the past. And I'm not trying to judge him. I'm trying to get him over that. Someone must have to have faith. We had a call from Moscow, Idaho about 4 years ago at our prayer meeting. 10:30 at night, I have to look at the clock. And we had a phone call, Moscow, Idaho. Didn't even know there was such a place. Like, how did you find us? You know, we hadn't advertised nothing. Their life flight, the baby to Seattle. Premature baby, didn't have a chance of living. Phone went dead. Midnight, they called back. So they're mad at me. I said, "Who are you?" "Well, somebody give your card out here." And they said a miracle has happened. But they're mad at me because when the plane landed, the baby was totally whole. I said, "Lady, why didn't you keep talking?" She said, "I woke up on the floor a half hour later." Our God hit her standing in the gap for the baby on the plane and going to Seattle. Let's take about a 10-minute break. We'll start again at 3. You'd have to get some...